I'm a little team. Thank you for coming. Thank you, Bob, and everybody. Panel will be a way of organizing. Molly has to speak first.
Presentation, and then we're going to have a panel discussion afterwards, and then we'll have time for questions. Unfortunately, we have to be out of here by 7:30 because there is another event at 8, so there'll be time, I suppose, for you to also talk to the panelists outside afterwards, and their books are also for sale. So there'll be time after that, and we can talk in the lobby. So first up will be Molly Haskell. I mean, luckily for me, you can find out exactly who all these people are on your programs. There are fuller biographies, but Molly Haskell will speak first. She's an author and critic. Presumably you know who she is because you would are here to speak, hear her speak. She is the author of From Reverence to Rape, and also most recently a wonderful book, which I read last year, about Gone with the Wind, which is called Frankly, My Dear, Gone with the Wind Revisited. So if that's for sale, you really should buy it. When we come to the panel, I'll just introduce everybody alphabetically. First is Laura Frost, who is an associate professor and chair of literary studies here at the New School, so she may be a colleague or professor for some of you. Then we also have Mary Gateskill, the novelist, who is here, and Susie Linfield, who is the author of The Cruel Radiance, Photography and Political Violence, which was a finalist for the National Book Critics Circle Award. And we have Kim Morgan, who is a film and culture writer, and she has her own blog. Unfortunately, it doesn't give me what her URL is. So Kim, when you get up here, you'll have to immediately tell us what
Sunset
URL. Sunset Gun. Okay, there you have it, sunsetgun.com. And that came from the audience, so obviously she's well known too. So that's who we are, and I guess I will go away so that Molly Haskell can come up and speak, and then we'll reconvene up here. So thank you very much, and enjoy the presentation. Should I just press play and see what happens?
Well, you're going to introduce it, right? Correct?
Well, I'm just going to say.
This is the visual aid. You know, everyone wants visuals, and I've never used clips when I speak, just because my thinking is that if you have a clip of a movie, you just want to sink into the movie. You don't want to stop and start listening to somebody. But it's also because I don't know how to manipulate the material, so. What I suggested was, instead of having clips or anything throughout the talk, start with something, clips from 10 or so movies, fateful first encounters. So this is the moment when the protagonists meet for the first time, and usually they are very charged. You can sort of feel the noose coming down right away. So I haven't seen them, but that's what this is going to be.
What a surprise to hear a woman singing in my house, eh, Johnny?
That's quite a surprise.
Gilda, are you decent?
Me? Sure, I'm decent.
Gilda, this is Johnny Farrell. Johnny, this is Gilda.
So this is Johnny Farrell. I've heard a lot about you, Johnny Farrell.
Really? Now, I haven't heard a word about you.
Why, Ballard?
I wanted to keep it as a surprise.
Was it a surprise, Mr. Farrell?
It certainly was. You should have seen his face.
Did you tell him what I'm doing here, Mellon?
No, I wanted to save that as a surprise, too.
Hang on to your hat, Mr. Farrell.
Gilda is my wife, Johnny.
Mrs. Ballon Munson, Mr. Farrell. Is that all right?
Congratulations. Oh, you don't congratulate the bride, Johnny. You congratulate the husband. Really? Well, what are you supposed to say to the bride? You wish her good luck. Good luck.
Thank you, Mr. Farrell. My husband tells me you're a great believer in luck.
We make our own luck, Johnny and I.
I'll have to try that sometime. I'll try it right now. Tell him to come to dinner with us tonight, Fallon.
It's an order. Come along, Johnny. We'd like you to get dressed. Look your best, my beautiful. This will be the casino's first glimpse of you.
I look my very best, Fallon. I want all the hired help to approve of me.
Is Mr. Dietrichson in?
Who wants to see him?
My name is Neff, Walter Neff.
If you're selling something...
Look, it's Mr. Dietrichson I want to talk to, and it's not magazine subscriptions.
Listen, Mr. Dietrichson is not in.
How soon do you expect him?
He'll be home when he gets here, if that's any help to you.
What is it, Nettie? Who is it?
It's for Mr. Dietrichson.
I'm Mrs. Dietrichson. What is it?
How do you do, Mr. Dietrichson? I'm Walter Neff, Pacific All Risk.
Pacific All what?
The Pacific All Risk Insurance Company. It's about some renewals on the automobiles. I've been trying to contact your husband for the past 2 weeks, but he's never in his office.
Is there anything I can do?
The insurance ran out on the 15th. I'd hate to think of your having a smashed fender or something while you're not fully covered.
Perhaps I know what you mean, Mr. Neff. I've just been taking a sun bath.
No pigeons around, I hope. Now, about those policies, Mr. Dietrichson, I hate to take up your time, but...
Oh, that's all right. If you wait till I put something on, I'll be right down.
I used to sit there half asleep with the beer and the darkness. Only that music from the movie next door kept jarring me awake. And then I saw her coming out of the sun. And I knew why Witt didn't care about that 40 grand.
Do you believe it, Pete?
Sí, señorita.
A real tough guesser might say that when he couldn't buy me off either, you decided to be nice to me. I don't always guess right. I may be wrong. I think I am wrong.
Sometimes I hate men. All men. Old men, young men. Beautiful young men who use rose water and almost heels who are private detectives.
Oh, I'm sorry, darling. I couldn't help laughing. But you should know by now that men play rough. They soften you up, throw you off guard, and then belt you one. That was a dirty trick. But maybe it'll teach you not to overplay a good hand. Now she doesn't like you. She hates men.
That was only the first half of the speech. The rest of it goes like this. I hate their women, too. Especially the big league blondes. Beautiful, expensive babes who know what they've got. Oh, bubble bath and dewy morning and moonlight. And inside, blue steel, cold. Cold like that, only not that clean.
Your slip shows, dear.
Hello. Come here, folks. Come here.
Sweet. Good to see you.
How's it, Jake?
Fine, fine. And it's good to see the little lady, too. What was your name again, honey?
Miss Harmon.
Oh, Miss Harmon. Swell. Blinky, you know the Swede.
Oh,
Miss Harmon, Blinky Franklin.
How do you do?
At the piano, Lou Tingle, and our hostess, Miss Collins. Kitty, Mr. Anderson and Miss Harmon.
Hello.
What are you drinking, Miss Harmon?
Ginger ale, please, plain.
Swede?
Brian Water.
Blinky?
Yeah?
Brian Water and ginger ale, plain.
Make yourselves home, folks.
Jake tells me you're a fighter.
Do you like the fights?
I'm afraid I've never seen one.
No kidding.
I hate brutality, Mr. Anderson. The idea of two men beating each other to a pulp makes me ill.
I saw all Swede's fights.
How wonderful of you. I could never bear to see a man I really care for being hurt.
Okay.
Oh, excuse me.
Plain ginger ale for you, lady.
I've changed my mind. You can sweeten it now.
No trouble whatsoever.
It's a nice apartment. It must cost a fortune to keep it up. I bet they need two servants at least to take care of it.
The more I know of love, the
the less I know.
Here's your drink, lady.
The more I give to
you. He said, here's your drink, lady.
The more I owe.
Oh, thank you very much.
Some that they couldn't get, but I'll try to describe them as vividly as possible. One that Kim told me about that was shown, I think, the other day called Wicked Woman, which is one of those real discoveries, a Poverty Row film that nobody's ever heard of, which was a real revelation. Maybe she'll talk about that after. I'm going to be a little bit, I figure some people will know, are very sophisticated about noir here, and maybe others not so much, so I will sort of give a little bit of a thumbnail sketch about noir itself. I thought I'd talk sometime in the late 60s. Film Comment, the film magazine, started a series called Guilty Pleasures. And each month, a critic or a director or a screenwriter would weigh in with a list of films that he'd loved, sort of dirty little secrets of a misspent youth that had lingered and shaped his tastes and sensibilities. The lists were proudly lowbrow, the movies beneath the contempt of mainstream critics and outside the pale of official film history. No socially conscious Stanley Kramer movies, no Academy Award winners, no prestige star vehicles, but lowly genre films. And this was a predilection that grew out of the auteurist enterprise of the 60s and 70s, initiated by the French, who after the war saw hundreds of films and began detecting sort of artistic patterns and sensibilities behind what was had been considered sort of Hollywood assembly line movies. The values of these films were often random and subversive, the termite art that the critic and painter Manny Farber would champion. Little in the way of sentiment or production values, and a lot in the way of edge and cool. They were also guy films, as were pretty much all the participants in the Guilty Pleasures feature, with its emphasis on male genres, westerns and gangster films, all little-known noir and pulp films by the likes of Sam Fuller or Edgar G. Ulmer. There was an inherent anti-female or anti-feminine bias, a kind of macho contempt for the romantic and prettified world of women's fiction and women's tastes, a bias that was itself a continuing and prominent theme in modernism. As James Naramore, our extraordinarily knowledgeable keynote speaker last night, has pointed out in his book, More Than Night, is the one of the many, many books on film noir, the one indispensable one. But he pointed out that there was an all-out attack on mass culture, which was deemed feminine, following World War I. Writers and artists, and especially those who'd been in the war and seen combat, couldn't bear, were repelled by the idea of anything that smacked of beautiful, beautiful images and euphemisms. And, quote, all forms of writing, from verse to journalism, became plain-spoken and masculine. Incidentally, the woman's film of the 40s was anathema to both the socially conscious Marxist critics and the auteurists, unless it was a Circean melodrama with its self-reflexive, therefore modernist bent. Now, of course, these guilty pleasures have been purged of shame and installed by film buffs and academics in the hipster canon. In cinephilia, as in society at large, there is love and pleasure, but very little guilt. Is there less pleasure because less guilt? That's something we might talk about later. You have to stretch to find something that might strike the readers of Film Comment as even borderline shameful. The Love Boat, or maybe emulate John Waters, who perversely came out of the art house closet and confessed to loving the films of Pasolini and Bergman and Woody Allen. Although this revolutionary shift in fashion through this, noir has occupied a special place, perhaps the first and most enduring crossover film, and I mean that in two senses. The first, a crossover from popular or subculture to academe, and is ensconced in the college syllabus, where the movies of Anthony Mann or Sam Fuller, or latter-day pulp meisters like Abel Ferrara, or Quentin Tarantino might have rough going, but crossover in gender, too, in that a genre or a type of film, we won't get into the discussion of whether it's a, why it's not a genre, oriented around male protagonists and a seemingly misogynist, doom-laden view of the relations between the sexes has been embraced, not entirely without ambivalence, by women. Noir is a hallmark of feminist film theory, and moviegoers of both sexes are still blown away on their first viewing of the snake-like Barbara Stanwyck descending the stairs in Double Indemnity, or Jean Tierney coolly disposing of a pesky in-law and leave her to heaven. Why has noir itself proved so enduring? Why does the femme fatale still seem so radical, and might the answers be related? Film noir, with its shift toward inwardness, its moody opposition to the can-do spirit of wartime Hollywood, its hapless protagonists plagued by existential doubt, was edgy, anti-moralistic, and characterized by psychological and sexual ambiguity that was generally the province of French films. Focusing on outsiders, it was also often made or influenced by outsiders, European emigres like Fritz Lang, Robert C. Odemack, Jacques Tourneur introduced German expressionist lighting and mood, while scripts reflected the stripped-down writing of Hemingway, Hammett, Chandler, and Kane, thus combining to create a cinema that was at the same time both spare and baroque. The very taboos and prohibitions under which they operated, under the production code and technical restrictions, because these were not necessarily all B films, but they were made on more limited budgets, created an atmosphere. And they were sort of used night lighting, and they turned studio sets into seedy, very inventively into sort of seedy locations, created an atmosphere of violence and sexuality that was both oblique and ubiquitous, interlaced with matters of money and class. An important precedent was the gangster film, which was darker than anything that Hollywood had produced until that time, a sense of pervasive corruption and cynical view of the system, and that dovetailed neatly with post-war feelings of disillusionment and male insecurity. Also, the obscurity was both literal and figurative in that the femme fatale was often played by a B-list star. Without the glamour lighting and treatment, she was even more opaque and unknown. And of course, there are huge generalizations, as for everything. Every time you talk about noir, the generalizations, they're more exceptions than generalizations. I mean, Rita Hayworth is the epitome of glam in Gilda. Lana Turner is all MGM star sheen in The Postman Always Rings Twice, and Jean Tierney is breathtaking in Laura. But of course, none of these women were actually femme fatales, as it turns out. They were all sort of what Parker Tyler called the good bad girls. But most of all, in the margins of society where film noir takes place, there is a sense of inner confusion, an old-world fatalism that was and still is rare in American cinema, and I include even the bleakest of today's movies. There's something, too, of Dostoevsky in this moral landscape, a disease of consciousness. It's the idea that man desires what is injurious to himself to prove his individuality. Obscurely motivated men, and even more obscurely motivated women, seek and find each other to mutually destructive ends. An atmosphere of disequilibrium prevails, largely created by the theme of gender reversal and all the paradoxes and anomalies it brings with it. Women wielding fatal attractions and hardware as well. Women whom audiences, like the men they entrap, despise, love, even identify with. I would suggest that part of the enduring power of this figure lies precisely in this confusion, in our mixed and hopelessly unresolved feelings. We're shocked to find ourselves rooting for these dames who are, by any objective criteria, purely reprehensible. Film noir offers a license for the truly bad woman, husband killers, psychopaths, not to mention just unpleasant, coarse, calculating, and duplicitous, bad in ways still not allowed in most movies, mainstream or otherwise. And I'm indebted to Laura Frost for reminding me of The Last Seduction, the 1994 film in which Linda Fiorentino plays, she's married to, it's not Jeff Daniels, it's the other one that looks like, who is it? No, he's the later. Oh, Bill Pullman. The sap husband, Peter Berg, is the Midwestern sap. So he is. They've gotten this money. She runs off with the money, leaves him, runs off with, on the excuse that he slapped her, which is just the sort of pretext she's been waiting for, goes off and ends up in this sort of cow pasture town, and treats Peter Berg as a complete sap, and she's the most, one of the most relentlessly, unmitigatedly mean women in all of film noir. And her lawyer calls her, she says, "Are you something or other?" And he says, "Are you still a self-serving bitch?" And she doesn't dispute that epithet. And Laura loved the line that she says at a certain point. She's talking to Peter Berg, who's sort of whining and, you know, "I don't want to kill people." And she says, "Spare me your brainless, countrified morality." But the interesting thing about this film is she could never be nominated for an Academy Award because it went to television first. John Dahl, the director, could not get distribution for it. I think finally, I'm not sure whether it got such good recognition at film festivals or it got raves in London, and it finally did get a theatrical distribution, but it was too inflammatory. It's still beyond anything that Hollywood producers can cope with. And, I mean, yes, we have butt-kicking action heroines and on television and in various permutations of noir, morally dubious female protagonists like Glenn Close in Fatal Attraction and Damages, Edie Falco in Nurse Jackie, Kathleen Turner in Body Heat and Pritzi's Honor, and so on. And you might even include the tough, geeky, antisocial girl with a dragon tattoo in the Stieg Larsson series. But with the possible exception of Fiorentino, they're a long way from the scarily seductive and irredeemable themes of classic film noir. There was a delight for feminists in the role reversal and the exhilaration of the bad woman in the context of so many virtuous and pliant heroines, which was the custom of movies throughout, more or less. Barbara Stanwyck, Bacall, Claire Trevor, Jean Tierney, Jean Simmons, Lana Turner, Jane Greer, Peggy Cummins, even the ones who look like, especially the ones who look like angels, are vicious and deceitful and deploy men as their henchmen, their hitmen, decoys, prey, sometimes loving them, more often love has nothing to do with it. Role reversal and its upside down view of the couple, suggesting a shadow of the opposite gender in all of us, seems both truer and more modern than all of the happy endings and false promises of traditional Hollywood romance. I think this is why the optimistic, happy ever love stories from throughout film history date so quickly, and role reversal turns out to be a staple of many of the films that retain their edge. The pre-code comedies, in which saucy Clara Bow or sexy Jean Harlow or raunchy Mae West bend and break the rules of decorum. The screwball comedies, of course, in which women give as good as they get, and the men are challenged and even ridiculed. The couples or the women in these three kinds of movies are also notably and notoriously without children. Marriage, where women are concerned, represents the taming of the free spirit. Underlying the privileges these heroines and villainesses claim is a fight against domestication. The knowledge that childbearing and child rearing are a maternal prison or at least a handicap in the struggle for independence or for any kind of unconventional life. They'd often rather be dead than fettered by maternal responsibility. There are no happy endings in film noir. The shrew remains untamed, punished for her transgression as she must be by disdaining her preordained social role. A lot has been made of the effects of the war, the return of soldiers already battered and disillusioned. Women had entered the workforce and they were concerned their wives might have found comfort elsewhere. And certainly this played a huge role. But the dangerous seductress responsible for the weakening of the male fiber is a theme as old as Homer, Euripides, Aristophanes, and the Bible. The woman of insatiable sexual appetites is an obvious projection of male fears and fantasies, and it's significant in these films where I think in one of my theories that goes all through this is how women constantly are modifying male fantasies. This fantasy is notably altered, if not absent altogether. I mean, at first impression, the femme fatale may seem voraciously sexual, but actually, and she certainly has few sexual inhibitions, but generally sexuality is used as a means to an end. Barbara Stanwyck or Lana Turner flailing and scheming to escape loveless marriages are the dark mirror image of feminism. Greed, the twisted form ambition might take, a tough, hard-bitten personality, the toll of the struggle for survival. I'm going to interject something here. I was trying to think, because you can think of all sorts of femme fatales that are sort of outside what we think of the purview as film noir. And I was thinking, for one thing, Scarlett O'Hara is definitely a pre-noir femme fatale, even almost a proto-noir, because she emasculates every man in sight except for Red, and he barely gets away unscathed. And yet she's so charming. And I was thinking about that in connection with my husband, Andrew Saris, the critic. We've been watching a lot of these noirs, and they're two that he really doesn't like. He's always shown Double Indemnity in his class, but he doesn't really like it. And he doesn't like Angel Face, which Gene Simmons plays an extraordinarily... It's a story where Herbert Marshall is the writer father, and he's made this marriage, and she hates the wife. I mean, it's a totally sort of covertly a quasi-incestuous father-daughter relationship, and she despises and wants to kill her stepmother. And she's this beautiful creature, and she's horrible. And Andrew doesn't like those two films, and I realize this because and he loves Vivian Leigh and Scarlett. Vivian Leigh has such charm that she gets away with it, where so many of the women in these particular ones in film noir, they don't have time to be charming, or they've used it all up. You know? So, and this is something fascinating, I think, to women. The sort of almost willed charmlessness of so many of these women. And I think there may be something in that, in the way men and women respond to them. But that was my feeling, because certainly Scarlett's bewitching. And also she has this other side of her, which is this fierce determination to survive. She will not accept defeat. So that combined with a charm. And in fact, she's quite a sort of contradictory person, as are these women often, which makes their the ambivalence and the sort of disturbance we feel, and sort of all the more reinforces that. Back to these particular Lana Turner and Barbara Stanwyck and their ilk. With divorce rare, stigmatized and not particularly equitable for middle or lower class women, murder was, well, sort of a reasonable option. And what's important is that however squalid a form, however negative these roles might appear, these women were part of a continuum of revolution, of resistance, and demand. The 20th century was one long struggle for rights, women's rights, individual rights, with, for women, milestones like the effect of Shaw and Ibsen's plays, the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory Fire, the WCTU, World War I, the fight for suffrage, the victory in 1920, going up to the election of 2008 in the awesome spectacle of a woman running for president. So in the course of these tumultuous battles, with the usual periods of repression, backlash, and retreat, women's images undergo radical and seesawing transmutation, sort of according to the zeitgeist. The new woman is born and dies and is reborn under another banner, even a disguise. The hard-living, hard-drinking flappers, while disavowing the over-seriousness of their activist mothers, does that sound familiar? I think that same thing has sort of happened in the last 20 or 30 years, avail themselves of the freedoms won without sort of giving credit or sort of demonizing the suffragettes, a freedom reflected in the uninhibited heroines of the pre-code movies. During the 30s, the Depression encouraged a collective sort of esprit de corps, collectivity, as did the war. As with dress, fashions in women fluctuate. In a review of newly released Rita Hayworth DVDs, The Times' Dave Kerr astutely noted the sea change between the star, Rita Hayworth, of 1944's musical Cover Girl and 1946's Gilda. In Cover Girl, Hayworth is a sort of mildly risque hoofer, and she's the embodiment, in Kerr's words, of good, clean, censor-proof sex. She was the kind of woman you could take home to mother. With a picture painted on one of the first nuclear bombs tested in the Pacific, or so goes the report, she was also more or less wholesome icon for the troops. As one of an ensemble in a Brooklyn nightclub, she renounces stardom and celebrity to knuckle down and stick with the gang, a clear pitch for home front solidarity. Then everything changes. 2 years later with the post-war Gilda, when overnight her sexuality becomes threatening and apparently voracious. And you can see all of that in that one scene with Glenn Ford, where the first moment she's just this radiant creature, and then this sense of mutual suspicion. They've known each other before, and he immediately assumes the worst about her and keeps assuming that all the way through. But as you probably know, she turns out to be a good bad girl, not a bad bad girl. But for one moment, Kerr was saying that Hollywood separated sex and sin. There was a possibility of sort of being sexy and not doomed. And not a whore, but then we have the film noir. And just as the movie goddess is a product of the collective imagination, so every society seems to get the femme fatale it needs or deserves, with icons of a dangerous female like Cleopatra and Salome taking on the contours of the cultural moment. Cleopatra has served as an archetypal real-world sorceress, a dubious but glamorous heroine in every medium, with creative license taken from the absence of any material evidence. But for the most part, as Stacey Schiff suggests in her feminist revisionist biography, she was denigrated or pigeonholed as a seductress to avoid giving her her due as a master politician and leader to rival the male monarchs of the day, and she could carry out her own murders. Delilah, too, has proved irresistible to myth-making. In the 14th century, Petrarch's Samson and Delilah are victims of love. In the 15th century, she becomes rather oddly an auspicious nuptial figure as she is painted embracing Samson on marriage trays. As an enchantress, she alternates between deadliness and mere foolishness in the hands of various writers and artists. In the Hollywood version, or the one we know best, the DeMille, Hedy Lamarr first seduces, then unmans, Jeff Chandler's Philistine warrior when she hacks off his curls. And it's actually one of her better roles. It sort of gives full rein to the cunning dominatrix within. I mean, there's something in Hedy Lamarr, I think, that is really capable of playing vicious, mean women. And she did it quite often, but in sort of miserable movies. She just didn't have much luck with her career. Salome, too, underwent the push and pull of the zeitgeist, from the Christian portrait of the dangerous female seductress known for her erotic dance, later crystallized, of course, as the Dance of the Seven Veils, to the woman in Wilde's play in Strauss's opera who causes John the Baptist to be executed and has his head on a plate and kisses it. But women in America, already enthralled to the Oriental eroticism of Rudolph Valentino's Chic, responded to Salome. Far from being embarrassed by what might have been considered a slur on their sex, they loved her boldness and welcomed a whole new type of female dancers who, like the Gibson girl, were athletic, powerful, exotic, not demure. This is Galen Studler has an essay on Orientalism and fan magazines in this period, and she cites Elizabeth Kendall as making this point about this new kind of woman dancer. Then, in Gustave Moreau's drawing, Salome is the emblem of fantasiecle decadence, now become extremely dangerous, an incarnation of old-world vice. Enter the vamp, European, or Euro-American, or perhaps Euro-trash style. Theda Bara, a.k.a. Theodosia Goodman, a nice Jewish girl from Cincinnati, would appear in both Salome and Cleopatra, but it was in her signature film, A Fool There Was, that made her famous as a vampire, then shortened to Vamp. This was adapted, I don't know if anyone's familiar, it's a sort of a fascinating history to me, from a Porter Emerson Brown. It was first a play, 1909 or so, and then he novelized it. And that, in turn, was inspired by a Kipling poem called The Vampire, The Woman Who Did Not Care. That was the first line of it. And the 1915 film with Theda Bara was meant as a cautionary tale. It sort of embodied all these ideas, these sort of eugenics of that period, this sort of pseudoscience, the idea that women were inferior, that the sexual woman was that sexuality in the female was a degenerative disease, and that would sap the strength of the white Aryan male and impede evolutionary progress. James Cain actually reportedly saw the movie, and he was quite impressed. It's a creaky vehicle, except for Barra's sort of outrageous performance. And he was quite taken with her white cheeks and dark lips and these heavy-lidded eyes and her inscrutable hauteur. And I think she fed into the images of Femme Fatale that he wrote. It's in this movie that she utters the famous line, "Kiss me, my fool." And then she grabs the guy. And this was the most graphic kiss ever shown on film to that time. And I think it beats a lot of what happened since. I mean, it's like a virtual rape. And this year, 1915, was, of course, also the year of D.W. Griffith's sort of horrifyingly brilliant racist epic, Birth of a Nation. And that caused, as you know, the resurgence of the Ku Klux Klan, and it fed into all the sort of prevailing bigotries about foreigners, about cities, about the democratization of the lower classes, and about the effete and the effeminate. See Teddy Roosevelt's cult of masculinity. In this context, the femme fatale found an especially congenial home in the medium of silent film as the demon temptress in the virgin whore dialectic that was a holdover from Victorian thinking, and also in the black and white palette and the broad melodrama of silent cinema. Murnau's Great Sunrise in 1927 posits a sweet rural couple, Janet Gaynor and George O'Brien, whose marriage is menaced by, when I saw this film some years ago, she was called the city girl. In recent prints, she's called the woman from the city. So that's what's happening there. No more girl, no more bad girls, just bad women. And she's played by Margaret Livingston. And she's this sultry sophisticated who somehow winds up in this rural place, and it's like she seems to have gotten off at the wrong train stop. I mean, what is she doing here? And then so she's bored to death, so she sets her sight on the poor farmer who doesn't have a chance with her. And she's very much in the extreme, almost Theda Bara-ish, dark, menacing, aggressive. I mean, she just also just envelops him. And he's this great, huge guy, but he suddenly sort of withers and shrinks in her grasp. And yet at the same time, to me, there's something that keeps her from being all-out evil. For one thing, the city that she represents, when you get there, it's full of all these jazzy, art moderne attractions, and even the bumpkin couple is lured to the city. So that exercises its charm. And when she looks around this rural place, and Janet Gaynor really does look quite dumpy for a while, and she looks around, it could be Betty Davis has that great line in Beyond the Forest where she says, "What a dump." And I think this is what the city girl is thinking. And also the way Murnau treats her, there's something quite poignant about her. But after the screening, I had two friends that were there, and they disagreed completely. They just saw nothing at all sympathetic about her. And these were two women who'd both been divorced, and they saw nothing that they could identify with the woman who went after another woman's husband. And I thought, well, maybe this is the difference between the film buff, who sees it in terms of other films as well as real life, or maybe it's that women are so hooked into the sort of burden of assuming responsibility for creating the family, for preserving the family, that they don't, that they're less given to enjoy fantasy than in the first place. And a similar incident occurred. I was on the Leonard Lopate show by phone about a year ago with Barbara Ehrenreich, and they were doing a piece on working women in movies. And the film they used, one of the main film, was Barbara Stanwyck in Babyface. Have any of you seen that? Yeah, it's a pre-code movie that sort of came to light recently. And in it, she comes from a small mill. She's lived in this grungy mill town. Her father has been is a bar owner who's been pimping her around. Mercifully, he dies. She leaves. She goes to the city, and she sleeps her way to the top of the corporate ladder. And there's a charming sort of shot where you see the lights go on in each successive step up. And of course, I thought it's wonderful. Most people who see it are just blown away because it doesn't have any of the sort of moral pieties and moralism that usually surrounds women in movies. But Barbara Ehrenreich didn't see it that way at all. She said, "Is this what women have to do to succeed?" And I realized that she was seeing it not from a cinephile point of view, but as a real-life woman. Here's this woman who's a feminist with a daughter or a granddaughter, and the granddaughter might have a earring in her stomach, or she might be going out and wearing tart chic, or anyway, just the concerns of a mother grandmother. Or it might be Barbara Ehrenreich, who's of course the author of Nickeled and Dimed, and is concerned with the struggles of working class women. So, to her, Stanwyck's Femme Fatale was simply an excruciating role model, and that sort of brings me to a problem that I have had as a I've always called myself a feminist first, I mean a film critic first and a feminist second, just because I believe in the art of film and not seeing it through an ideological lens, and the whole idea of a progressive agenda or positive images. And also, the collision would come from time to time. And one time there was a panel, it must have been the early 80s, and on it were Joan Hackett and Eleanor Perry, the screenwriter, both sadly dead of cancer now, and I and maybe somebody else. And we were talking about women's roles in movies, and at some point Betty Friedan raised her hand and says, why can't we have a rating system for women in movies? And we would have W++++ for a positive image of women, and W-++ would be the latest Sam Peckinpah atrocity. Well, that was the era of Straw Dogs. Actually, that movie looked very different to me when I saw it some years later, but at that point it was just sort of skin-crawling, the Dustin Hoffman, the whole sort of rape scene. So my objection was, first of all, maybe this was Jones, because she was actually Catholic. She said it would be like when the Catholic Legion of Decency used to X a film, that was the first film everybody would go off to see. So if you'd had W-, all the men would lubriciously go out to see that. But my objection is, how do you determine what's a positive, what's a W++++? Of course, the movie companies wouldn't carry these letters in their ads anyway, so it was all moot. But how do you determine it? Is a W-plus a true portrait of woman oppressed or as a second-class citizen or struggling or victimized? Or is it more a hopeful, idealized, or idealistic portrait of a woman triumphing over the odds, a superwoman? Well, there's no answer to that, because it can be one or the other or something in between. It's too crude a tool to analyze film and character. And I think this is sort of my theme in general, and with the Femme Fatale, that's where it would seem on the face of it to be strictly a male fantasy, but she's constantly being modified and qualified and contradicted by women themselves as individual actresses and as characters, and sometimes in the tension between the two, by women in the audience who bring their own fantasies to bear and respond accordingly. And it's this fluidity of film, its reciprocity with its audience, and its being a collective form of art that distinguishes it from the work of individual artists. I mean, you could take Picasso and Bello. Their women are very much projections of male fantasies. But in fact, even these women, I think, as distinct from women by some other artists and writers, seem to have a fairly robust life. They sort of exceed the grasp of their creators. But the film, I mean, Naramore did a beautiful job last night discussing The Big Sleep and the way that Lauren Bacall had established suddenly this dazzling persona into Have and Have Not and this electricity with Bogart, and they were now lovers and married. And in The Big Sleep, Hawks wanted to, and Warner's brothers wanted to recapture that spirit, but it was a Chandler book, and Chandler's women, Chandler had a far more sort of malignant and uncharitable view of women. He felt that the detective should be a loner and should resist women's seductions, whereas Hawks had a much more benign and embracing view of women, and his temptresses were almost, there was a kind of self-mocking quality. And Naramore discussed how there was this collision between these two views of women and Bacall's new persona and trying to make an amalgam and not quite working. But this is what goes on. These are the considerations, and it's why it can't be analyzed in a kind of abstract way. And I'm always distressed when I read some theoretical writing. They never even mention the actors. I mean, the actors are part of the writing of the script. When people require a film to be progressive, they have something in mind like a strong woman or a woman who's her own person. But that doesn't necessarily make for good drama. I mean, you have only to look at some of the film noir remakes. There's some with Jessica Lange in them, and they just don't work at all. And also, Mildred Pierce, I think it would be a lot of fun to talk about Mildred Pierce a little bit at the end, because what happens when you remove the noir elements of Mildred Pierce, the meanness and the vulgarity and all sorts of other things? And in the course of talking about Joan Crawford, Michael Curtiz, 46 film versus Todd Haynes series on HBO. But it's precisely this ambivalence, this unsettled and unresolved quality that makes the femme fatale a film noir endlessly tantalizing. We root for a woman to kill her husband. Progressive? No. But enticing, because we sense and somehow respond to subterranean forces at work. The question, what do women want, has never seemed more relevant. Money? Safety? Do they know? Do we know? Do we know what they want? Do we know what we want? If men as boys are meant to exit the enclosure of the nursery and transcend the mother, women have the more complicated task of both separating from and identifying with the mother, of wanting both independence and a man to lean on. For all their doubts and moodiness, the men are fairly simple. For example, in Gun Crazy, John Dahl likes guns. He's good at shooting. It's the only thing he's good at. He discovers he can't kill. Peggy Cummins, how many people have seen Gun Crazy? Well, that's, the rest of you have a treat in store. It's one of those, it's the Poverty Row by Edgar G. Allman that just sort of was a guilty pleasure that became one of the revelations. No, sorry, it's not. I'm thinking of Detour now, getting to, no, but this wasn't quite Poverty Row, but it's also sort of rough edge. Peggy Cummins in her carnival sharpshooting show looks like Doris Day in Calamity Jane, but she's much more of a killer than he is. Yet she's torn. I mean, and this is true of also of the Gene Simmons character in Angel Face. There, I mean, Cummins says, I'm afraid, that's why I kill. I'm afraid to kill, and I don't want to kill. But then the minute she gets that gun in her hand, you see this light in her eyes that suggests otherwise. And this, but at the end of that film, and also Angel Face, after behaving in this incredibly dastardly way, both women soften a bit. They seem to want to exonerate the man to instead of taking him down with them. So I think these fascinating questions for me arise about the nature and impact of specific femme fatales and the degree of malignancy they represent. There's a spectrum with one extreme occupied by the completely and irredeemably evil and the other by the well-intentioned but hapless harm-doer like Joan Bennett in Scarlet Street or Gloria Graham in The Big Heat. Who is the baddest of them all? This question provides an entry into the whole discussion of these competing factors and the interplay between the role as written and directed. Is the baddest and savage, the mean and blousy bully of Edgar Ulmer's deliciously low-rent Detour? Phyllis Dietrichson, the master manipulator of Double Indemnity? Jane Greer, the heartless seductress of Out of the Past? Faith Domergue, the schizophrenic manipulator in Where Danger Lives? I mean, some people think, well, she's not so bad because she's a schizophrenic, so that's her excuse, you know. I'm not sure about that. And what about the powerful, if benign, dominant female played by Ella Raines in The Phantom Lady, determined to rescue the man she loves? She's a wild woman. She's this beauty, refined looking, and she goes after the people who are concealing information that would exonerate the man she loves. And she has this look that absolutely shatters this bartender, and it's more penetrating and terrifying than any male gaze. And gaze, of course, is the term that the feminist film theoretician Laura Mulvey either invented or brought into currency to describe the transaction, which she sees as this sort of purely male spectatorship, which transfixes the woman sadistically into an object. And my problem with that has always been that it seems to almost reinforce the idea of the all-powerful male. And on the other side, other people have written some modifying responses to it, and one is Galen Studler, who's written about the masochism, which is sort of the antithesis, and I'm going to get into my own version of that. But is a woman less reprehensible, less immoral, therefore more sympathetic if she loves the man she entraps? Is Barbara Stanwyck a fraction less wicked because she refrains from shooting Fred McMurray a second time? Or is there something secretly or not so secretly exhilarating about the actions of a completely immoral heroine when love doesn't enter into it? Can we fail to be awed by her intelligence, her remorseless refusal to recognize or abide by ethics and the rule of male law, her unabashed greed? And finally, how much does the personality of the actress herself have to do with such calculations and responses? Peggy Cummins, I just said, says she's afraid up to shoot, but then the light in her eyes says something else. And it's and this feeling of anger and hate are somehow exciting in the original Mildred Pierce, more exciting than this kind of realistic capturing of the day-to-day, though that has virtues too. And he does, I'll say, he does capture even more, I think, well, that would be hard to say because one can be more realistic about these things now, but he does capture, he does bring out the incestuous impulses and the forbidden impulses. So here, film noir is the place where the Oedipal mother and the pre-Oedipal mother, Freud and Sacre Masoch, fight it out. The Oedipus complex takes its most obvious form in the triangle of the hero, the Madonna, and the whore, or their variations of, the protagonist's covert need to win the sexualized mother from the father and simultaneously punish her for her sexuality. This we see in fairly classic form in the hard-boiled detective fictions of Hammett and Chandler. In Murder, My Sweet, the film made from the Chandler, where the femme fatale, you just saw the blonde Claire Trevor, perpetrates all manner of evil, but doesn't finally vanquish or undo the hero played by Dick Powell. No unraveling here. Civilization, by way of Freud, depends on the male subject's detachment from and transcendence of the mother. In his exclusive focus on the primacy of the phallus and the Oedipus complex, Freud ignored feminine identification on the part of men and suppressed the powerful, aggressive, seductive mother and any consideration of her subjectivity. It is on the other side of film noir that we find the return of the repressed. For example, in movies adapted from the novels of Cornell Woolrich, Mama's Boy, and Stalwart of noir fiction, he's the author most famously of Rear Window, and also The Bride Wore Black, which Truffaut made into a movie. In these films, we see the obverse, men completely demoralized and helpless, rescued by female knights in shining armor, Ella Raines in Phantom Lady, and June Vincent in Black Angel, not femme fatales. In fact, in both movies, the femme fatale is killed right off the bat. But smart, gutsy women who, like Grace Kelly in Rear Window, become detectives. Raines and Vincent set out to find evidence exonerating the men they love who've been wrongly convicted of murder. But also, and interestingly, they have dual roles. As if to acknowledge the femme fatale within, these proper ladies become sultry sirens in order to penetrate the lairs of the villain, so they get to dress up sexy as well as being proper. Robert Siodmak, who directed Phantom Lady, is also responsible for two extraordinary tales of men pummeled by demonic mercenary females, both starring Burt Lancaster. The Killers of 1946 is a minor masterpiece adapted from a six-page Hemingway story in which a young ex-prize fighter played by Lancaster virtually invites death after his bewitchment by two or three-timing Ava Gardner. He can take a lot of punches, his detective buddy has remarked at the premature end of his boxing career, and that might stand as the motto of the noir anti-hero, especially Lancaster. He's wonderful, too, in these early roles. The same punching bag vulnerability marks his character in Crisscross and leaves him open to the murderous machinations of Yvonne DiCarlo. And for a recent and more explicit rendition of a wicked mother-dominated triangle, one that might have had Freud scurrying under his couch, look no further than Stephen Frears' The Grifters in 1990, adapted from a novel by noir specialist Jim Thompson. Here we have a son, John Cusack, thoroughly undone by the combination of Annette Bening's seductively greedy girlfriend and the even greedier monster mother played by Angelica Houston. More often than not, in the masochistic film noir, the man walks in with his eyes at least half open. Fred McMurray knows every step of the way what he's getting himself into, deeper and deeper, and he keeps going. And Mitchum, it's why Mitchum is such a great noir protagonist. His eyes are always half closed, or half open, or half shut. There was actually something wrong with his eyes, but he never got it fixed, and that sort of heavy-lidded somnambulist becomes the perfect kind of signature for a willingness to let down the guard. He doesn't want to wake up. In his book, Observing the Erotic Imagination, the psychoanalyst Robert Stoller, writing about the aesthetics of excitement, suggests a necessary aspect of erotic excitement is that one must keep oneself from knowing too much, from knowing what is going on. This applies both to the characters in noir and to us who are alternately attracted and repelled. and our ambivalent excitement depends on a delight in deception, theirs and ours, and some sense of identification with sin. That's what is too often missing in these neo-noir films, where directors pay superficial and self-conscious homage to the noir's idiom, parodying a form that already has large doses of self-parody to begin with. With the 40s seductresses, we feel a sense of desperation, social. So it's this charmlessness I was mentioning. They just don't have enough left over for charm. Social, psychological, or even purely neurotic, that we don't feel in the well-heeled heroines of screwball comedy, or even the femme fatales of neo-noir with their wider array of options. The 40s babes want power the only way they can get it, whereas the demon ladies of neo-noir, or the women in contemporary Hollywood movies in general, don't have the same sense of imprisonment or can't acknowledgement. Perhaps it's a different kind of prison. It's a sort of wide openness that's more threatening in the number of options and expectations. But in all too many movies, suitably called chick flicks, the only desperation is how to find the right wedding dress, and sin is the designer faux pas. The best of the neo-noir are the ones that recapture the frisson of transgression, either by updating from within or reimagining noir altogether. Movies like Basic Instinct or Thelma and Louise as a kind of variation on the fugitive couple. There are a number we could talk about, but I'd suggest you take a look or another look at Bob Rafelson's Black Widow of 1987. Anybody seen that? Remember that? Okay. That's the one with Teresa Russell as the deadly seductress who keeps marrying rich men and devises very personalized ways of killing them. And Deborah Winger is the FBI agent who sort of psychs her out and tracks her down. The men are good, there are good male performances in it, but it's really the women's film, and it's this cat and mouse duet that we follow. And we in the audience are sort of in the position of Winger, the nerd. This is Hollywood's version of a nerd. The spectator, who becomes obsessed and almost paralyzed by her mixed feelings, part of her wanting to see Russell arrested and convicted, and part of her enthralled by the woman's cleverness and panache. This is where the real erotic tension in the film lies, but somewhere along the way, the movie makers lost their nerve and came up with a redemptive and happily heterosexual ending. My fantasy denouement, since the movie has plenty of over-the-top moments, would be a violent or passionate confrontation between the two women, perhaps a crazy Liebestod shootout like the one between Gregory Peck and Jennifer Jones in King Vidor's Duel in the Sun. And on this appropriately perverse note, I will close.
So I'm going to take this so that I don't have to stand behind the panelists when I talk to them. So if all of you want to sit, those are the seats. It's like a lineup. And I will then make clear who each person is. Are there not enough seats? Oh, someone's going to have to sit in the red chair. Molly. At first, I wasn't sure if it was Duck, Duck, Goose, and you know there was going to be someone left out. But Molly Haskell, obviously, is in the red chair. Next to her is Susie Linfeld. Next to her is Kim Morgan, and Laura Frost, and then Mary Gateskill. I think some of us, we had seen a brief summary of Molly's talk, I mean, that she had sent a couple of weeks ago before she had worked everything out, and everyone had so many ideas and responses immediately. I know, Laura, that you had had some thought-provoking questions that you were immediately asking. I think, Molly, you even interpolated one of the questions because of the Linda Fiorentino reference. And I guess, I mean, Laura, I don't mean to pick on you first, although you are alphabetically first, too, so that's a convenience. What do you think of the term femme fatale, the film noir? Because there seemed, when we were meeting in the quote, green room, that there was a lot of debate even about what those terms meant. So what Molly laid out, I mean, how do you react to it?
Actually, what I was most struck by in Molly's terrific talk, very rich and informative, and I'm sure we're all going to go run out and rent the films that we haven't seen already, is that how much of this discussion is structured around these dichotomies. Are these films progressive? Are they regressive? Are the women attractive? Are they grotesque? And Barbara Ehrenreich's feminist meter is something. That's quite an idea. But the idea that you could sort of calibrate politics and give them a grade, I think points to some of the problems inherent in this topic. And it seems to me that there are two basic ways of interpreting the femme fatale. The first is political, and the second is more in terms of fantasy. So if we read these politically, it seems to me that these are films that are about women's ambition, whether it's sexual ambition or financial ambition or just agency. And it's always punished. And just going back, you raised the moment of Hillary Clinton running for president. There was a moment when NPR's Ken Rudin actually compared her to Glenn Close in Fatal Attraction. And he said, she's just going to keep coming back and no one's going to stop her. Just to prove that point, that female ambition is grotesque, basically. So that's one way of reading this, sort of misogynist way. But I think actually, and you got to this at the end of your talk, yes, they're inflected by historical realities and politics, but they're also fantasy. And to me, what's the most powerful about this genre of film is that it shows that gender stereotypes, I know they're supposed to be very bad, but they can be very compelling, attractive in the realm of fantasy, both for men and for women. So we see male masochism, we see female sadism, and also, and this is something that you touched on, that we're in fantasy, it's very exciting to not know who that other person is, to have somebody, a character who's very opaque. And so this is something that's constantly thematized through the film, through the films. In The Maltese Falcon, Humphrey Bogart is constantly asking Mary Astor, who are you really? You've got to drop the schoolgirl act, and so on. But it seems clear to me that that's what noir desire is about. It's about not knowing. It's about curiosity in the realm of fantasy. And that's something that carries, it's true for men, it's true for women, and it carries over into the neo-noir films as well.
Do you think it also represents a reality that's within women that they would like to express, that they see on screen? That it's not just a fantasy, that a lot of women at the time, especially after the war, let's say, a lot of women had worked during the war.
Right.
Then the men came back.
Right.
Then they had to become homemakers. Mm-hmm. A lot of women probably didn't want to become homemakers. Maybe they didn't want to have children. Maybe they wanted to be like Jean Tierney and leave her to heaven. Maybe they wanted to have their honeymoon and not have the sad child, interrupting the honeymoon. And of course, what she does is evil, but it's an extreme representation of what is within a lot of women that want to live outside of the system. Betty Davis in Beyond the Forest, you mentioned that also. She hated living in that town. She hated it. She wanted to leave. Every time she heard the train, she'd just hear Chicago, 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 Chicago. A lot of women are trapped. And so when they see these films at the time, I wonder how many women at the time sort of, it was like a projection of what they were feeling inside that they couldn't escape and the alienation that they did feel. And men, too. It's the way they always get punished, but at the same time, there's something that you celebrate with these women, especially the ones that are a little more conflicted, where they're not quite the bad, 100% bad.
Well, we were comparing them to the gold digger movies of the 20s and 30s, right, where they're not punished. Right?
Yes.
At the end,
yes.
The gold... No,
like Babyface.
Right, right, right.
Like Babyface, yeah. Or Night Nurse.
Yeah, yeah.
Or, you mentioned The Blue Angel is a great early precursor to the Femme Fatale.
I don't know anything about film noir, so I didn't realize it had such certain parameters, and I was wondering why she wasn't, that Marlene Dietrich in that movie wasn't on the list here, because to me she's like the ultimate Femme Fatale.
I agree, yeah.
And also something, a quality about her that I associate or think of in reality as well as fictional, actually more in reality. I'm most interested in the relationship of this sort of beautiful, seductive ideal, how it intersects with reality, and even the most grubby, mundane level of reality. Often the fatal woman that I've known, as well as the fatal man, because I definitely think there's such a thing as a fatal man, there are often people in my experience who have a strange combination of being very delicate and almost vacuous, but at the same time kind of housing this extraordinary, almost like primal or almost supernatural power that they don't even quite know they have or know what to do with.
So to pick up on the Blue Angel, how do you explain the professor?
I don't.
He seems to exemplify what you were talking about, Molly, the lame film noir man.
No, I don't think he's lame. I think he's somebody he's very passionate. He's someone who's a profoundly passionate human being who doesn't know his own passion. He comes there really thinking he's going to put her in her place.
That's right.
And be moral. And I don't think he's lame exactly. He's just somebody who's never, he does not know himself. And I also think I don't think she intends to destroy him. I think destroyers actually quite often do not intend to destroy their victims. It's more like she's been beat up a lot. He seems to be, once he puts down the whip, he seems to be really genuinely sweet. She hasn't seen much of that in her life. She needs it. She's really actually been knocked around enough. She's in the mood for something tender and gentle. She's charmed by his little bird noises and stuff. But then, and she's weak. In my mind, she's a vacuous, and particularly lazy, not especially bright human being, but with that extraordinary power that she still has and doesn't quite know what she's doing with. She's charmed by him at the moment. She actually really does like him. But then she gets tired of him because somebody else comes along. It's her boyfriend who's the sadist, who's the real destroyer. But because she has a weak temperament, she gets pulled into that like she got pulled into the other guy's sweetness and charm. And she doesn't care that much. It's more like he's roadkill.
Well, how much in terms of film noir, I mean, and the kind of avatar of the femme fatale that you mentioned, you know, Theda Barrow, even though she was American.
Well, the point of all these people is that they're European. I mean, there's a big distinction. They're European.
Right.
Dietrich is European. Garbo is European. Louise Brooks was not, but she played a European style
and
person.
Like Theda Barrow,
she was the real amoral temptress.
Was Theodore Goodman. I mean, so that's what the question I have is,
she
how much of it is Americanized? I mean, forcing these...
No, the American girls don't do bad things like that. Only bad European ones. They bring in the
But how much, decadence. I mean, then what about Phyllis Dietrichson in Double Indemnity? I mean, is she not... I mean,
well, this is what's unusual, to have American women behaving so badly. A European woman is expected, you know. That's what the whole idea. But the whole... And this was the one, I think... Jim Naremore quoted it last night, but what's his name? He was Orson Welles' producer, Houseman. John Houseman wrote this violent diatribe against all these movies and how immoral they were, and really he was expressing all these feelings about sapping the fiber of American this and that, and this was what was shocking, because they were on our soil doing these bad things.
Well, one of the things, I mean, it's so interesting, I mean, Kim, you just picked up on it, and Molly, you had said it in your talk, I mean, is that that one of the sort of thrilling or subversive things about these movies and film noir and femme fatale is the gender reversals, I mean, that are happening. And so in talking about that, what you're also seeming to say is that there's a kind of reversal of morality. I mean, you know, that European morality is brought to America. I mean, a kind of weird reversal of the, you know, European failure at the end of, you know, the war. Yeah. America is a victorious power at the end of the war, and here these bad European women are sort of somehow Americanized in these films, as if, you know, World War II was somehow lost. I mean, the very men who had won World War II come home and are victimized by Barbara Stanwyck and you know, Rita Hayworth.
Mm.
I mean,
I think Susie wanted to talk about the marital thing. Didn't you have something?
Yeah, I mean, I think of the femme fatale in movies as a critique of monogamy and of marriage. This sort of the sine qua non of the femme fatale is the ability to break up someone's marriage, hence And Mala, you called it the rule of male law, so patriarchal marriage. The femme fatale has great contempt for middle-class mores. She either leaves her own marriage and has an affair, or, as I said, she breaks up someone else's, which is even better. But I'm wondering, we live in an age where marriage and monogamy are in such tatters. And so I'm wondering, I think it's a lot more difficult now to be a femme fatale, both in the movies and out of the movies. The days when Ingrid Bergman was forced out of Hollywood for leaving her husband and shacking up with Rossellini and having a baby are far gone. Now it's almost required in Hollywood that you have a child, at least one, out of wedlock. And Molly, you had said that the fight against domestication is part of the femme fatale, which I think is true. But again, Hollywood and real life, as Mary said, outside of Hollywood have changed so much. So I think of Angelina Jolie as a real modern-day femme fatale, and she did break up Brad Pitt's marriage and all this stuff, except that she has like 8 kids. So here's the femme fatale as supermom. And I just think that because the strictures of marriage and of sexual mores have changed so much in the society, I think that the femme fatale is a less subversive figure.
Well, also because of just the sheer availability of sex. I mean, women have lost the power to say no. That was a huge leverage. And that was what made these so shocking, because the women were so sexual. I mean, in screwball comedy, they didn't have sex, you know, and nowhere else did they. Mm-hmm. It was the taboos. You couldn't have children out of wedlock. Divorce was...
Right.
There was no divorce, so this was in a context of complete repression.
And so living in a less repressed age, I think, leaves less room for the femme fatale. Maybe something else will emerge. It's not that they don't still exist. And actually, in terms of your question about fantasy, I think that women do. I don't think this is just a male fantasy at all. I think it's also a female fantasy. But things are a lot looser now. And in a way, the femme fatale is most powerful within a very tight structure. We live, I think, in a loosened time. And now I'm just going to throw out a completely random thought, which is the anti-femme fatale. I just saw the new version of Jane Eyre, a book that I adore. And Jane Eyre is the anti-femme fatale, right? She gets the man just through pure goodness of heart.
Wait a minute, I don't agree. I think that Jane Eyre is a template for screwball comedy. The minute she sees him, she knows she has a power, because he's not dashing and good-looking. She's plain. If he were dashing and good-looking, she would be mute. She would be self-conscious. Mm-hmm. But he's not. It's a power play, just like screwball comedy. And there's some very funny lines where... And I think captured in the film rather well, some of them. Of course, they can't have it all in. But there's this byplay where she holds her own with him verbally and mentally.
She does, but she doesn't get him. I think she does not get him through sex.
No.
She gets him through
her
virtue.
Mind.
Well, so he's sort of, in the new version, he is actually sort of good looking, which threw me off a little.
Yeah, he's too young and too good looking, I think.
But it made me think, one of the things that it made me think of when I was thinking about Jane Eyre and then about this panel is also just how much work it is to be a femme fatale. It's a lot of work. You have to always, you know, the hair has to be in a certain way, and the makeup and the clothes.
But I think
Rita Hayworth alluded to that. She said something like, you know, she had all these very bad, dysfunctional marriages. And she said, I think it was after she and Orson Welles split up, she said, what was her real name?
Cancino.
Margarita
Cancino. What was it?
Cancino.
Cancino.
Okay, so she said something about how they go to bed
with Rita Hayworth
but they wake up
with me. Well, she just said with me.
With me.
Yeah.
And so I...
Well, she was
a
very shy person, apparently. But.
Yeah.
Go to bed with Gilda, right. Wake up with me, right?
So, you know,
Molly?
Not Molly.
Just to pick up on your point about where is the femme fatale now, or is it possible to be a femme fatale now? I think it's notable that most of the neo-noirs, a lot of them, verge with pornography in certain ways. Mm. So, for example... is it Basic Instinct? The most famous scene, right? Mm-hmm. The most freeze-framed movie scene in history, apparently, is when Sharon Stone is crossing and uncrossing her legs during the interrogation, and, you know, no undies. But a lot of the films, Jade, a lot of these neo-noirs sort of have these moments that verge or sort of intermingle with pornographic tropes. Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering how that connects. I mean, you're saying we have more freedom.
Well, we just have to up the ante. I mean, my God, the Sharon Stone character in that film is, well, she's an intellectual, right? She's she's got
writer.
It all.
Yeah.
And I think also this is, in something like The Last Seduction, she's entrepreneurial.
Yeah.
You know, she's, I do think they have to be reimagined at a higher level of and it's very hard because you don't have these restrictions. I think the restrictions played a huge important part in their impact.
I think there are some interesting neo-noirs, though, that with David Lynch. I think Mulholland Drive is an interesting neo-noir. Both of those characters are definitely like certain forms of femme fatales, and they are living in a world, Hollywood, which hasn't changed much for women. And the men are alienated, the women are alienated. They also in Lost Highway, also especially in Blue Velvet, you know, where there's a idealized community and underneath that is rot and corruption, just like in Mulholland Drive. And it's not simplified. These aren't simplified female characters. These aren't just, let's make a sexed up version of a lady with great gams and fishnet stockings. No offense, those are wonderful.
Mary,
this has nothing to do. What I was going to comment. This doesn't really have to do with the ideal world that we've seen, the fantasy representation in art, in cinematic art in particular, of this particular ideal. I agree with what everybody's saying. That's changed very much, and I agree with Molly. It's because of the lack of restriction and the far greater availability of sexuality and sexual expression, if you want to call it that. That's changed that picture quite a bit. But I think in real life, there will never be a shortage of fatal women or fatal men. I think what fascinates me is the way that the ordinary intersects with the ideal and the imagined, and this sort of place with a completely ordinary person, a woman or man, but let's say women in this case, since that's what we're talking about, can wander into this particular perfect point where her characteristics, her natural seduction, ability to seduce or predisposition to seduce, whether she's even trying to or not, and somebody's imagination, and just the light she had that happens to hit her at that moment, she will become fatal for somebody. And because I'm a writer, I feel compelled to represent in a perhaps boring way in comparison with these beautiful images. But there is a short story by Charles Baxter who in his own odd way defines the femme fatale really beautifully in one line. And I'll describe it as quickly as I can. It starts out, it's called A Short Course in Nietzschean Ethics. And it's about two male roommates in college. One of them, I'll call him Carl, I don't remember the name, he's a total pain in the ass. He's constantly going on and on about power and how he doesn't care about women, he doesn't care about love, he's only into power. His roommate increasingly finds him a big bore. Anyway, Carl gets a girlfriend. We don't even know if she's pretty or not, I don't think. So let's call her Karen. Anyway, long story short, the protagonist steals Karen away from Carl. They move out together. Fast forward to the future. They're living together in domestic bliss. Carl comes to the door. Carl is a wreck. Carl's career is in the toilet. He's a complete destroyed man. And he says to the protagonist, "You did this to me. You humiliated me. You destroyed me. And you know it." And the protagonist is like, "Carl, I'm sorry, but I didn't do this to you. I don't know what you're talking about." "Oh, yes, you do." They go back and forth until Karen walks in. How does Carl greet her? "Karen, Queen of Darkness." And Karen does not say, "Huh?" Karen says, "Hello, Carl." She knows exactly what he's talking about. We don't even know if she's pretty or not. She's ordinary. But for a particular moment, she was Carl's Queen of Darkness. And that will never stop happening.
Well, on that note, I think we have to turn it over to questions for just a few minutes. Unfortunately, I feel like sort of like coitus interruptus. We've worked up to this, and you can't respond. So you'll have to talk to the panelists outside. But we have time for two questions, I think, two or three questions. Are there any questions? Oh, in the back.
Hi. This may be very unpopular, but there was just a controversy in Queens. And all through history, art history, women have been the personification of vice and luxury. And this is paintings and sculptures. And I remember a Herbert Block cartoon of a prostitute standing in a doorway. This is the pacifist period just before World War II. And there's somebody labeled youth, and she's saying, "Come upstairs to war. I knew your father," was the caption. Mm-hmm. So what I'm saying here is that... oh, God.
Is there a question?
You lose the
train.
Yes. Is that one of the major themes in noir pictures is betrayal. And another device is the flashback. And what I'm saying here is that women are used as the personification of betrayal. And to make it political, the betrayal was the betrayal of the working class in the 30s during the Depression. Anybody want to... beat me over the
I'm
head with
sure
that one.
That's a question
the,
or
of the 30s, because
a statement.
Yeah, I know, but
I've shut my mouth.
Things like
I'm glad it's
out
over.
Of the past or somewhere in the night, really, they all flash back before the war.
Uh-huh. Oh, I see. So you're saying it represents the betrayal of the women represents personification of the 30s.
John the Baptist and being uh-huh. betrayed, or Samson being betrayed. The woman is a personification of vice and luxury.
And well, that seems to be trying to put it more into a political frame.
Yeah.
I think Molly, you were explicitly sort of removing it from that kind of political sort of frame.
Yeah. I mean, there were all these currents going on in the 30s and 40s, and there were the Red Scare, and there was the repression, and there were raids, and this and that. And I think the women. I mean, the themes we've already talked about of the male insecurity coming home from the war and the disillusionment. That's all there. But I don't know about the work. I don't see the plight of the workers somehow. And I mean, I see the working class very importantly in this. I think this is another thing we have to remember, that these women really don't have great options. The little roadhouse that in The Postman Always Rings Twice is you get a sense. This is one of the you don't have kind of that sort of working class world, that hardscrabble working class world. I mean, you have it, but you don't. So maybe you see it in some independent films now, but. But I don't see it as any kind of
a lot of the women
collective.
Also were frustrated, I think, to be living in the man's world. It's a man's world. And so when you watch Gun Crazy, the frustration, I mean, it's obvious symbolism that it's phallic. It's a gun that she connects with, and she's a sharp shooter and so good at it. And yet, you know, she's not going to be able to make it in that world. You know, she couldn't make it as... She really is like the man in that picture. I mean, she's the one that pushes him to do everything. She's the one that gets him to rob the bank.
Well, they all think, I mean, she thinks she wants to go straight and have just a nice married life for about
no,
5 minutes.
No, yeah. But, I mean, it seems like there's continual frustration in these women, in these femme fatales that, as I said earlier, I think exists now. Women feel frustrated now. Women feel frustrated in work. Women are sexually harassed in work. Women are constantly... downgraded for many reasons. And so when you watch it, I think it's timeless to watch a film noir now. You can relate to it. But women are still judged for not having children. Women are still judged for not being married. Women are judged for killing their husbands.
Well,
let's hope that doesn't cease. I mean, I, in most cases anyway, and I'm not even married, so but I don't want them to be killing their friends. It's so funny that, I mean, I read in The New Yorker this week, there's an article, it's about comedies, I mean, a profile of Anna Faris, and it's a story called Funny Like a Guy by Tad Friend. And so what you're saying, Kim, seems very current in a debate, even in comedies. I mean, quote Stacey Snyder, who's the CEO of DreamWorks, and she says, "In my experience, girls revealing themselves as candid and raunchy doesn't appeal to guys at all, and girls aren't that into it either." But somehow she doesn't seem to have pegged any of you on this panel. So, I mean, what do you say about that? I mean, as a sort of
are you calling me candid and raunchy, or
no, the people are in the on the movies that we saw, not
I know what
you
saying.
On the panel. I mean,
I wouldn't
interest.
Call. Well, I mean, as I said, I mean, they are trying best they can to work within the man's world, and that will have often by duplicitous measures, because how else are they going to do it, you know, but to compete with the men?
Femme fatales, I think, are not raunchy at all.
No.
I mean, part of their power is that they're very contained and controlled. They smolder a lot, which is sort of the opposite of raunchiness. And again, I think you mentioned in your talk that femme fatales now are sort of not as good as they used to be. And I think that's true. And if you think of someone like Kathleen Turner in Body Heat, because always now I think there's an element of irony. And the clips that you showed, the real femme fatales from the 30s and 40s weren't ironic. They weren't. Right. There was no meta level, I don't think, going on. They were really in these characters. Now we know too much. We think we know so much, et cetera, especially about sex. So it feels to me that they're always. It feels to me that femme fatales in movies now are actually parodying the role more than inhabiting it. But again, I think it's very hard, given the social and sexual mores that we live amongst. For it to be otherwise.
Often they were repulsed by sex, too.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, if you, like in Decoy with Jean, is it Jilly? Jean Jilly, she is not interested in sex. She's just interested in money, and that's
Detour.
It.
Detour.
That is
Detour,
not a
sexy no.
Character. Yeah.
And a lot of the marriages are sexless and unhappy, and, you know, they're sex is something that they're using, but it's not necessarily what they're enjoying. It's like what you're saying, they sex it up now as if they're just, that's what they're interested in, but that's not necessarily the case.
Sometimes,
yeah.
Well, unfortunately, that's all we have time. Oh, okay, you look so sad. Make it quick.
Well, the one that when you opened the panel, you were talking about the different things that are attractive about noir and the femme fatale. And for me, it's all about agency. And recently, Charlie Rose, on his interview with both the producers and the director of the first Stieg Larsson girl with the dragon tattoo, asked him, you know, he asked them, what do you think it is about, you know, this story that has so many women so captivated? He was playing all innocent, like, hello. And the answers in both cases from the director and the female producer were, they believe that it is the pent-up anger and frustration of women finally realized on the screen. And of course, everyone I talk to, they all say, of course, why, I mean, who even needs to ask this? But because of the girl with the dragon tattoo, I think we're gonna see a whole spate of copycat type things, I hope. What, as far as the panel's concerned, is the future of the femme fatale?
So the question being that with the popularity of Stieg Larsson's novels and the movie, that, you know, that this women's interest in that is a result of a kind of pent up anger and frustration, and given that, what is the future then of femme fatale?
Well, to use a recent example, and this is something I walked out of, and I know you're never supposed to talk about something that you walked out of, but Sucker Punch. Did anybody? Okay. Oh, my, right. So this was supposed to be an extension of something like Kill Bill or the empowering chick film. And I know you've written about this, Molly. It was clearly calculated. I mean, Tarantino, I think, can be criticized in a lot of ways for just recycling his own pulp fantasies. But this was, there was really nothing empowering about it at all. It was really cheap and one-dimensional. And fortunately, it's been skewered at the box office. But I do think that the flip side of this sort of hyper-empowerment or hyper-agency can look grotesque, can end up making people look like caricatures. And that's what I think is so interesting about noir, is that the best of it will show women struggling to achieve this kind of agency, but actually will also show the kind of effort that goes into it. Something like Wicked Woman, where you see her really trying to make it, and it's not pretty.
Well, I think Elizabeth Salander really is a new, something new. I think there's something, because she's modern, she's computer-wise, she's not a femme fatale in any traditional sense, but she is, she has this amorality, she has a lot of quality, and you know, this is, it's a prototype, it's not anything around. I think very often what's happening, there's some interesting roles of women on television, but they're sort of in a mold, or there's a template. I mean, there's a new Dana Delaney movie where she's a medical examiner, and it's like House in female clothing.
Body approved.
Body approved. Yeah. So I mean, it's like they're very comfortable if they have a mold or a template that they can use on. But within that, there's some actually. I think she's an interesting actress, and Glenn Close does interesting. I mean, there are some fascinating and complicated women around. It's just not anything like the old femme fatale, because her seductiveness is based on these taboos, which don't exist.
Well, on that note, thank you all very much. Thank you, Molly Haskell, and our panelists.